Hi, Paul Elam here with A Voice for Men. Ladies and gents, please fasten your seatbelts securely. We are expecting turbulence ahead. If you've been reading almost any mainstream UK online news source lately, you may have come across the story of Mark Pearson, a 51-year-old artist who was just found not guilty of sexual assault by a jury in London. Mr. Pearson describes his ordeal as a Kafkaesque nightmare and told the press after his acquittal that he's still bewildered as to how the accusations made about him ever got to a trial to begin with. Indeed, when you take a look at all the circumstances and the abundance of exculpatory evidence, you have to wonder how this ever came to charges, much less a trial. Let's take a look first at what was alleged. The accuser, a famous actress and entertainer, alleged that when she encountered Pearson at rush hour on a train platform, he forced his hand inside her knickers and forcefully shoved three fingers in her vagina. The penetration was followed, his accuser insisted, by a forceful blow to her shoulder. But there was just one problem with that story. It never happened. CCTV cameras caught the supposed incident on video. What that video reveals is that Pearson brushed past the actress as they took opposing paths on the platform. You cannot tell that there was even contact between the two, and the encounter itself lasted about a half a second. Half a second. The alleged victim in this case is asserting that in half a second, Mark Pearson managed to crouch down, drop the newspaper he was holding in his left hand, push his hand up her skirt, past her yoga tights, and then past her undergarments, force three fingers inside her vagina, withdraw his hand, stand back up, strike her on the shoulder, retrieve his newspaper, and walk on like nothing happened. The CCTV cameras revealed that he never broke stride as he walked past the actress without incident. The accuser also claimed that she staggered and screamed for help on the crowded platform. The cameras proved this to be untrue as well. That takes us back to Mr. Pearson's very important question about how this thing ever got to trial. And it was indeed a question asked by the judge in the case, who sources tell me had suggested to prosecutors that they drop this case and dismiss charges due to lack of evidence. As always, though, there's a story behind the story. Pearson's acquittal comes on the heels of a 2015 pledge by Director of Public Prosecutions Alison Saunders to increase rape and sexual assault prosecutions by nearly a third. Saunders, coincidentally, was under fire last year for failing to prosecute a member of her own office for child abuse. Link to that story in the low bar. That has raised speculation that Saunders may now be sponsoring blind prosecution of anything male for the sake of her political career. In the Daily News coverage of this story, human rights activist Aaron Pitsey said, and I quote, "The CPS have recently been wrongly targeting men, and it has got to stop. The CPS had no business going after him because there wasn't a case there from the very beginning. At the moment, women seem above the law. They can do it in domestic violence cases, simply pick up the phone, no evidence required, and have a man removed from his family and his children. And they can do it with rape too." Unquote. Leave it to the inevitable Miss Pitsey to call it like it is. This case also highlights another serious problem with how allegations of sexual assault are handled pretty much anywhere in the global media. If you read the links provided in the low bar, you will see the name Mark Pearson, the actual victim of this story, plastered everywhere. Photographs of him are also abundant. Even though the most crucial part of his ordeal is over, meaning he's been cleared of charges, the fact that he was accused will now follow him for life. It will stain every Google search on him, and all who know him or come to know him will know that his name is associated with an alleged sexual crime. Meanwhile, the accuser, and most likely rape liar, will enjoy a media blackout on her identity. She will not be charged with filing a false police report. The prosecutors, who clung so doggedly to unjustly crucifying Mr. Pearson, will not take a second look at his accuser. They will just move on to their next target. His accuser will not have her reputation tarnished or suffer a single consequence for the lies she told that have forever damaged someone's life. She will get away with it scot-free. Personally, I find that unacceptable. At the very least, it is time that false accusers are publicly named and shamed for what they do, especially in cases like this where the evidence she lied is so overwhelming. With the help of some anonymous informants who are intimately familiar with the trial, I have discovered the identity of Mr. Pearson's accuser. Her name is Sawad Fares, an actress who plays solicitor Usha Gupta in The Archers. The Archers is a BBC Radio 4 serial that has run over 60 years and is the most listened to non-news program on Radio 4 with over 5 million listeners. Fares is also slated to play the character of a high priestess in an upcoming episode of Game of Thrones. One source speculates that the prosecution's decision to proceed with prosecuting on her behalf is in part based on the actress's high profile. Personally, I don't think so. I think it is pretty obvious that Alison Saunders is on track to compete with Mary Kellett for prosecutions that are driven by sexual politics. I think she's willing to prosecute any alleged crime that involves a female victim and a male perpetrator. The fact that Fares is a celebrity is just gravy. Both Saunders and Fares should be facing charges on this one, but of course, as you know, both have privilege that will exempt them from any tangible consequences. That, however, will not prevent conscientious citizen journalists from shining a light on the problems and the people causing them. I'll be bringing you any updates on this story as they become available. Until then, see you next time.